broadband penetration and the nation's gross domestic product. We are desirous that discussions at this summit focus on some, if not all, of the following key objectives. Strategies to harness the immense potentials of broadband for economic development, how to resolve the persistent challenges and obstacles on the way to faster rollout of broadband across the country, including the very nagging issue of right of way procurement in Nigeria. Finding new ways of attracting new subscribers to broadband services. Discussing how to resolve the challenges to broadband pricing and the question of competition. And of course, considering new and collaborating methods of expanding coverage into hitherto uncovered locations in Nigeria.
Financial services, heavy investments on broadband, tourism, I've been brought to today, communication and infrastructure, education, e-learning, distant learning, e-healthcare, energy oil and gas, all depend on broadband. And we've seen that as a major driver of great economies across the world.
I do believe that if Nigeria can deliver the national broadband plan, it's going to have a major impact on life in this country. From our perspective, I think we see the ability to change and get this broadband penetration moving in three broad ways. And I think there needs to be a big paradigm shift in how government addresses things and how the regulators address it and how the operators do operate as well. So if I take each one of them very briefly, there is a role for what we want to do. On the policy level, we have to accept some of the things that Joseph said. It cannot be left all to private sector to do things. Everybody has a responsibility. So in terms of infrastructure, we really have a major problem. Everywhere else where there is going to be our peer groups, we talk about 30% broadband penetration in places like South Africa, Ghana, Morocco, Egypt. The infrastructure that is provided as a minimum, good roads, access to power, proper planning permits so that when we make the fiber, it's not cut every day. You get multiple fiber cuts every day on multiple routes, so even when you have redundancies, all that, it's all because of lack of planning. So there has to be some extra support that does it. From the regulatory side, there needs to be a change in how we approach things that we distribute and also makes available within the leaders. I read that slide that just had, which had the fiber coming in and how it gets and what the bottleneck is last month. I think we have to accept that in Nigeria, we're not going to have fiber to the home, communities. It'll be in the corporates, it'll go to the states, where people live and large telecom issues. We're talking about this BGC or to what's 1,000 the likes. Yes, that is natural, but the rest of it is primarily going to be wireless. Now what are the constraints that the leaders that the regulator could put in place that would help further accelerate this? In terms of spectrum, we need that the ability of the 700, the 800, we feel those are more important for access and coverage at this time than say what we call the 2.6, which as was mentioned by a previous speaker has been postponed for now. 2.6 is very good, but it's better for closer indoor coverage rather than for increased access across the country, so we need to face that. I think one of the things that government also must do is change the dynamic of spectrum auctions. It should not be seen as a revenue-making affair. Yes, there should be a fee paid, but also if you make this available, I think the statistics that would show the development you get could be Corona being very good for business and the availability and social planning back. So making it available to the right social partners is important. This will require looking at the industry structure. We have many subscale operators who are either sitting on this and are not using this and needs to be taken. Collaboration should be encouraged amongst operators. It's currently rather difficult to do. So there needs to be this paradigm shift, as I mentioned earlier, in terms of how we allow to collaborate to get access to this spectrum. And new things around sharing, which Joseph mentioned in his interview, some of us as operators are actually collaborating quite a lot in terms of how we can do national roaming, active sharing, and refunding our spectrum. So the faster we can get approvals to do these things, it will certainly spur our ability to address these issues. And I think coming to the question of fiber and whether they should, some of the operators have rolled out extensive fiber infrastructure and whether we need a national backbone, I don't believe that is the way to go. I think what it should happen is, if the right playing field is set, you can have access to this infrastructure that has been built by all the operators. Tetisen Avenue, one of the later entrants that came into the market, and we had to build out over 3,000 kilometers because rules around sharing were not there. So we started, I think, with the regulator 2 years ago, the wholesale lease line study, which would bring about cost-based pricing for fiber. Now, if this still hasn't been concluded and still hasn't been implemented, I think once you have the rules set, and it's very easy for whoever to approach the next person to say, well, I need access to your guts or to your fiber to share or to buy sort of prices that don't make it uneconomical.
It would be great if there would be a host of typical Nigerian stuff, Joseph referred to as content, I would say applications, but I mean the same, stuff that helps Nigerians, the real Nigerian fashion, to share cars, by the way, when they think Nigerians are really good at sharing cars. there might be an app in there. It's not up to me to determine that, but let's say Nigerian entertainment, Nigerian educational stuff, Nigerian health things. I mean, the availability of applications of all sorts is actually quite limited, and I think that if it would be possible to make that happen, and I fully told them, just refer to the startup week and that sort of stuff, I think there's a lot of space in there for Nigerian applications, which are about efficiency, entertainment, and all the other things. That should create a lot of pool which would help us over here. Because again, just pushing broadband is not bad, it's not enough. If there is a would become an atmosphere in Nigeria of people getting really happy, entertained, more efficient, healthy, better educated through all of these applications, then I think not only would life become easier for us here, but it would be another atmosphere amongst government, amongst consumers, amongst businesses. And I think what the digital economy could mean for Nigeria, and David also mentioned that it's massive. There is room for a much, much bigger ICT industry providing all these Nigerian applications, but that will also change all the other economies in this country. And that's what Joseph also showed on one of the sheets. So I think the demand side to create a pool is hugely important.
I think there's still tactical opportunities today that could be better harnessed, regardless of what the most strategic situations are. And probably have about 5 points around this area. And the first is on fiber to home. I just mentioned some examples of fiber to home. And in previous life, I was actually in one of the projects to deploy fiber to home, so what I would call manages it. The opportunity that is not happening today, as much as a lot of operators want to embrace it, is that it needs to be a partnership with what I would call developers and facilities managers. So I would love to deploy fiber into a managed state you know, but if I had to pay for the daughter, I had to pay for the wiring, I had to put everything together, it would not make that much sense if I had to send it door to door. So one of the things that we talked about previously is how do we integrate broadband services as part of facility services, such that if I move into a managed estate, I can actually get internet as part of what I pay for. I pay for water today, I pay for power today, why not pay for my internet services? This will encourage operators and ISPs to actually then go into clusters of estates that can create a lot of return of investment because it's partnership with facility managers. The second is on what I would call a smartphone. We talked about, you know, I mean, you can't have internet without having access to internet for users. Smartphones will be the access media for users of the future. You know, there will be a lot more people accessing the internet on smartphones and there will be accessing the internet on laptops. Now, for Nigeria today, smartphone is still very low in penetration. Now, the third, if I look at the National Broadband Plan Initiative, was around connecting schools. Schools and universities are fragmentedly buying internet service. It's expensive, it doesn't make economic sense, they're not using economies of scale to make it small. There's an opportunity to turn the NGO Brain Initiative into something that is actually a national initiative. In fact, schools are all of the universities we connected and they were sharing a common infrastructure, it will be more than what cost effective for them to do so. And I hope that I will see that. Fourthly is on small businesses. I mean, Nigeria is full of small businesses. We're waiting for our world to say, you know, 9 out of every 10 person that we see at the community have a small business of some sort to make ends meet. Statistically, it would say that businesses that are powered by internet of some sort or with technology of some sort will probably grow twice as fast as internet as companies that are not. Now, for small businesses today, they not only need access to internet, they also need some kind of internet, whether it's or the other. I can't count the number of people I see in the Google, Hotmail, email addresses, credible business owners who have not yet got into that place to adopt this. They don't have websites, they don't have domain name, and a lot of them in Nigeria. We launched a couple of last year in Intel, which was web services, which is building on website, domain name registration, and even just some of small businesses, you know, to have a web presence. This is a very, very important initiative that should not have taught as ISP and technology. So you have to make the small businesses. And lastly for me is on what I would call corporate and companies also embracing, creating an enabling platform for the users to embrace the internet. And today, I'm sure I saw Paul and Julian on the panel of data today, and I have a lot of clients on my network today. One of the things that we're talking about is everybody wants to grow internet penetration. Everybody's trying to try to sell service. Everybody wants their customers to go online and do something or the other. Why don't we sponsor the site? It would be much easier. If I as an engineer don't have to worry about getting onto my, what I would call my supplier site to be able to transact from two businesses, then it can be sponsored. If all organizations sponsor their web services today to make it easier for the engineers to go onto those web services, then you will see a lot more adoption. It will be much easier for people who are not being around at the data plan, are not using that enough on the mobile banking. It's free, I will just use it. So these are the opportunities that I see in spite of the challenges that all of us today have had to embrace.